Good evening and welcome to the LSE's Shaw Library. My name's Hugh Tomlinson. I'm from Matrix Chambers. This is the sixth seminar in a series which has been going on for 2 years, jointly presented by Matrix and the LSE. The purpose of the series is to bring together lawyers, judges, practitioners, academics and others to consider current cases in international law. We've got a very distinguished panel tonight, which Davika, who's chairing it, is going to introduce in a minute. But welcome to everybody, and I'm sure it's going to be an extremely stimulating discussion. Thank you.
Many thanks, Hugh. And welcome to you all, to our distinguished speakers, and to all you clever lot who managed to deal with the last minute venue change and make it to this room. So yes, welcome from me as well to this latest in our LSE Matrix series. I'd like to acknowledge the support as well for this seminar of the LSE Latin America Centre and the LSE SU Argentina Society. I'd also like to acknowledge Francisco Quintana, who's an exceptional young scholar and LLM student here, without whom this seminar would not have happened. As you mentioned, the LSE Matrix seminar series deals with current cases in international law. The trial of the Juntas can be described as a current case in the same way that some of us play fast and loose with the term contemporary music. It brings to mind a quote attributed to Picasso: "It takes a very long time to become young." And indeed, outside the Latin American context, the trial of the Juntas has taken an exceptionally long time to become recognized as part of the contemporary history of international criminal law. International criminal law texts always contain their mandatorily brief history of international criminal law, and I can see many of our international criminal law students here and other international criminal lawyers. We know we start with Nuremberg. We might make a brief pit stop at the Tokyo War Crimes Tribunal. If we're being particularly thorough, we'll deal with the Eichmann trial. And then what we do really is acknowledge a gap until the Yugoslav and Rwanda tribunals. When I searched through my library of international criminal law texts, not a single one mentioned the trial of the Juntas. Argentina is mentioned as the place that Eichmann was stationed when he was collected up. But this incredible 1985 trial involved the prosecution of nine leaders of three successive military juntas for crimes including widespread and systematic torture, illegal deprivation of liberty, and aggravated homicide during the dirty war against subversion between 1976 and 1983. I cannot think of a better panel to help us rewrite the history of international criminal law from the Anglophone perspective. Luis Moreno Ocampo, an Argentine lawyer, professor at Harvard University, and the first prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, we are privileged to have with us tonight. He was assistant prosecutor and truly the public face of the prosecution of the trial of the Juntas, which received widespread television and media coverage. Professor Ruti Teitel also hails from Argentina and is the Ernst Stiefel Professor of Comparative Law at New York Law School. Her most recent book, Globalizing Transitional Justice, was just published by OUP. I had a copy. Excuse me. Hot off the press, but in my hands. So this is her most recent book, published by OUP, and that examines transitional justice. It's this path-breaking book, Transitional Justice, that led us to ask her here tonight. That examines 20th century transitions to democracy in many countries, including Argentina. And I must clarify at this point, while international criminal lawyers can be accused of neglecting the trial of the Juntas, transitional justice scholars certainly have not, and Professor Teitel is one of those at the forefront of this scholarship. Professor Gerry Simpson, we all know him. He's our recycled chair. He went away for a while, but now he's back, so he's our recycled chair. Of course, at the University of Melbourne for a long time, We're delighted to have him back. We know him as our international criminal law professor, but also author of Law, War and Crime. He's also written or co-edited a book with Kevin Heller on the hidden histories of war crime trials, which does not deal with the trial of the Juntas, but we might argue, and we might literally argue, whether or not that could qualify as a war crimes trial. So, the structure for this evening, Professor Moreno Ocampo will speak to us, and Professor Teitel and Simpson will respond. So we look forward to hearing these three in conversation before opening up to the floor. Thank you, Professor Moreno Ocampo.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. I'm not a professor at Harvard now. I was a professor, a visiting professor, when I was appointed prosecutor, so I left. And my prosecutor career went on with my academic career. But I'm very glad to be here, because for me, reflect on these activities I did as a prosecutor is a way to decompress myself. I like to understand what I did. So because I know what I did, but I like to understand the context. And right now, I'm working on a book on the ICC, but reflecting on the Junta trials, for me, it's very interesting to compare, to show the connection between both cases. So that's why my title is From Nuremberg to The Hague Through the Junta Trial. So just to touch, this is the only thing I like to say. If you remember one thing today from me is this. The normative study of the legal system should focus on the norms interpreted and applied by all relevant actors. So normally we analyze judge decisions. But judges is in some way the easy job. You have no constraint, you're the master, and you can say whatever you want, applying the law. A prosecutor has a different problem. He has to collect the evidence, protect the witness. So it's not just one normative mandate, you have a complex mandate. And then you have other actors, political actors. They have a much more complex mandate. And you have the different actors have different mandates. And what I will present to you, using the Junta trial example, how a legal system is basically the sum of all these different pieces. And I believe lawyers have to understand the real game. Lawyers have to understand not just what the judges decide, how the other actors are working, and how they are confronting. That is, for me, what I like to explain at SEC, and today I would like to explain about the Junta trial. So, going to your point, this is a graph developed by Katherine Sikin. Who of you is a lawyer, study law? Can you raise your hand? Is someone who is not a lawyer here? Okay, great. This is a political scientist. I am Harvard now, but I'm doing research for my book, and also with Katherine Sikin, we are teaching one course on basically the politics of international law. And Katherine developed this idea of the justice cascade. And for her, what she found is a trend starting at Nuremberg that she identified Greece and Portugal as two important national cases in the 70s who promote the idea to make leaders accountable for massive human rights violations. And then 85, the Junta trial, who has a huge resonance in South America and so in East Europe. And it's funny for me because for me, in those days was, okay, we started the same year as CNN, so it was not so TV, but New York Times was there, everyone was there following us. What's happened is the landing of the Argentina process was complicated because we had military rebellions and the government changed the law. And that's why I think we lose popularity. This is my explanation why Junta trial disappeared into the focus. But I like this idea to show in Nuremberg and Tokyo, then you have Greece and Portugal, Argentina 85, and then ICYDR with the end of the Cold War, and then ICC. So it's a continuum. And it's not about one or the other. They're blurred, they're connected, they're working together. Okay? Just to give a glimpse of the Junta trial and show I was young. Okay. Oh, the guy went.
So I had to face my family.
Predicator.
La ferocidad y la mentira son las dos notas del sistema de represión. Por eso hoy se hace necesario averiguar la verdad y juzgar a todos los que hayan violado la ley, en particular a los poderosos, a los máximos responsables.
That was a new thing. And then I was appointed the Chief Prosecutor of the ICC, and it's in some way similar mandate, but in a different, totally different context. So the question for me is, how was possible to do a trial in 1985 when these guys in 1976 had all the power? So these two pictures are the same guys, 76, all the power, supported by the US, supported by my country, and 9 years later, paf, in front of the judges for the first time. Because interestingly, in Argentina, since 1928, no democratic government ended its term. It was always a coup d'etat until 1985. So doing a case and the dictator were assuming that it would be immune. So the idea that this guy were nine members, including three former presidents, were prosecuted was not in their mind. And in fact, in those days, was in the mind of no one. No one was requesting that. Catherine Sikin was, in those days, was working in Uruguay. She remembered in the 70s, no one was requesting accountability. So for you guys, young, there was no internet in those days, there were no cell phones, and no one was requesting accountability. And international criminal justice did not exist those days. I just was reading a paper from Ben Ferenc in 1997, explaining, okay, Europe was okay, even if not repeated, nothing happened. So that was in those days, 87, 85, nothing was happening. And suddenly, junta trial. So that was, for me, what explained that? And in some way, I see international cases have similar problems, because many people, many scholars during the 80s were saying, do not challenge the army guys. Do not do that. You are jeopardizing your transition to democracy. It's crazy what you are doing. Similar today, when you read the scholar of international relations, they believe we are crazy with international criminal law. No? David Bosco say it's an anomalous institution, the ICC. And Stephen Krasner, who's a pope of international relations, he said the law is international law is counterproductive. And that was, for me, that was what was the kind of thing. I have these Kevin Heller people discussing legal issues and ignoring them, and international relations people ignoring the lawyers. So I have two types of scholars, and they ignore each other. And they analyze the same kind of problems with totally different paradigms, contradictory paradigms, but they are not debating between them. And I think that is a mistake, and I think we should, because then we're not understanding the real game. They are not understanding the law, and those people, and I think just the judges, or their ideas, are not understanding how different actors apply norms. And for me, we don't need to be sociologists or political scientists to understand the game. We can apply a normative analysis, a legal analysis of the different actors, not just the judges. That's what I'm trying to propose. I repeat the idea here, in order to be clear. And that's the point for me. The judges have to implement one normative system. They are the masters, they have to do that. If they do something different, it's wrong. The other actors have different normative demands. And that is the issue we have to define. What are the demands? For instance, Abraham Lincoln, he was a president of US, and he said, as a president, I cannot free the slaves, because according to the US law, we accepted the idea of slavery. However, as a commander in chief of the army, I can do whatever is needed to win the war. As a consequence, he decided to free the slaves in the South. So, in order to get 50,000 more soldiers, black soldiers, and in particular, to force the army of the South to stay in the South, because they had to control the slaves. So he achieved two different goals with that. And interestingly, when the war ended, the only states with slaves were in the North. The South were no more slaves. So Abraham Lincoln, for me, is a good example of a politician who understands how to use the law, how to take the law, respect the law, but then use the law for his own goals, respecting the law, but using political goals. Perfectly valid. And we are not focused on that. And that's a problem for me, because then what I saw in the diplomatic and political arena is this guy has no idea of the law. They don't care about the law. When I indicted Mr. Haroon from Sudan for the genocide in Darfur, I was discussing with an ambassador in New York, and I told him, look, ambassador, you have a chance now. If you force Bashir to arrest Haroon, you stop the genocide in Darfur. No one else will do something against the victims if President Bashir put in jail the master of Darfur. And he said to me, oh, it's a great idea. We cannot do it. Why not? Because we have no idea how to implement these type of things. We have two tactics, bombing or nothing. In the middle, we have no idea. In those days, I was thinking it was a joke. It's not a joke. That is the way, the primitive way that our conflict managers, our politicians, our diplomats manage conflict in the world. They don't care. Bombing, they threaten with a bomb, as soon as the other guy says, I will negotiate, ceasefire, fine. Because they want a ceasefire, that is the goal for them. And we need to do better. And to do better, we need to integrate how politicians understand the law. And that is, for me, what I feel I need to explain or to show. And like here, can you see this? No. I developed 14 different topics that explain what happened in Argentina, and at the same time show different actors applying norms. The first one is the Alfonsín, as a candidate, proposed to investigate the junta and ignore the self-amnesty that in the last few weeks of the dictatorship, the military tried to impose. So he, as Lincoln, present a legal point to win elections. And in fact, you will see him, because in his demonstration, or when he had when he was giving speeches, he started repeating the constitution. So it was totally legalistic. And he was a politician who understood in Argentina, people are tired of dictatorships, it's time of law. And he used, in the political term, the law. And it was very important, because in October 30, 1983, Alfonsín was elected, so 51.75% of people in Argentina vote for him. So to vote for the law, you need a candidate to propose the law, and people follow him. And then, immediately, the first decree was to request, to order, because to the army lawyers, to start a case against the commanders. And the same day, it was 5 days after his assumption as the president, 5 days later, he created one of the first truth commissions, CONAMEP. And immediately, December 22, so 1 week later, the Congress almost unanimously adopted a law declaring null the self-amnesty of the dictatorship. And 2 months later, February 9, they adopt a new system to allow the army to do the case themselves. Because the Alfonsín plan was the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces will do the case. And then they were organizing the law to help them to do it. And I was saying, proceeding to help them to do it. Then in September 2084, so 9 months after the appointment, the CONADEP issued its report explaining what happened in the country. As a reaction, the Supreme Court of the Army said, we have nothing to investigate here. Everything was legal. So the court, the federal court, who was had the role to oversee the military court, decided to take the case itself. And so in October 1984, the court took the case. And we collected the evidence in 5 months, between November 84, 1985. We selected in the same month 700 incidents, That was peculiar because in Argentina, a civil law country, prosecutors have no right to select cases. In the civil law country, you have the duty to investigate all the cases you have. So we find a way to legally say, okay, we prosecute for this incident, acquit for the others, but for this, you have to convict. So we took some responsibility. Then, something to remark that was so crucial, speed. When I received the full referral, I said, okay, I have to do a strong investigation. For 2 years I was investigating. When I came with my indictment, there was no appetite for the case. Political appetite disappeared very fast. The judge understood that, and they took 800 witnesses in 5 months in public hearings. And the court was scrupulously protecting the right to defense, even giving them a chance to go to the Supreme Court in the middle of the trial. Interestingly, one of the things that, in particular in the civil law countries, they discuss more is the moral liabilities. Roxine, I don't know, who knows who is Roxine? Okay, so just Francisco. Francisco has to explain to them. Okay, in Germany there's a big discussion about this issue, though. My country is following German tradition, so we had a big discussion on moral liability. And then the conviction on punishment was a big deal because there were 5 people convicted, 4 acquitted. But the judges took the decision to make this discriminate between different arms. So, as you see, these are 14 different decisions and taken by different actors for different reasons. But to understand what happened, you have to understand the 14 and how they integrate each other. And you see how the entire country was moving to prosecute the guys. Okay, let me see. This is Jose Alvarez, who is basically explaining the idea I'm trying to present. And I was thinking it was a good idea to quote entirely him. Jose Alvarez say, as international lawyers, we emphasize rules, not institutions or process. He presents the contrast with the study of US law, which emphasizes institutions and processes. He said, the modern study of law involved the study of the 3 branches of the government. It involved the study of the interaction between the chief executive and the Congress or parliament in enacting and enforcing law of various levels of courts charged with interpreting that law and the hierarchical relation between each other and of diverse government agencies that are delegated power by the executive and legislative branch of government to issue regulations in specific areas of the law. Again, finance, commerce, health, etc. Throughout, emphasize the complex institutional process by which national law is created, interpreted, and enforced. I believe this idea, we should go with this idea to the international system. And see how all this national case like Juntas drive to understand how this can work. If not, you don't understand what you are talking. Basically, that is my point. If we are just taking one piece and believe this is mostly the only important piece, we don't understand the game. Either you're political or you're legalistic. In both cases, you're wrong. Okay, let me see. I will just to present the actors. This is a film done by the. It's a film done by the same dictators, and basically the Juntas. I like it because it shows how people is just reading. No one protested the coup d'état. This newspaper was saying the former president fell. This is the guy going, no problem for them. Everyone is quite calm. This newspaper says a new government. It's not saying a coup d'etat. The newspaper is saying a new government. So, and they are respected and received by everyone. Because in some way people were afraid of the violence of the guerrillas, and the government used it to take power and establish themselves. So, what happened? Why they fell so badly? Malvinas. Oh, this is. I love this. I have a translation. I would.
Compatriotas, Hemos recuperado sin rencores las islas astrales que integran por legítimo derecho el patrimonio nacional. Si quieren venir, que vengan, les presentaremos batalla.
He was saying, if they want to come, come on, we'll fight with you. Okay. Very likely, so I'm sorry for that, but Margaret Thatcher is a good liberator. So she defeated the Galtieri people, so we're back to democracy. So suddenly the dictators filed and they called for elections. And during the elections, I like to show this. This is the beginning of a speech that Alfonsín gave in front of 1 million people. And what he's saying is basically,
que marchamos, que luchamos para constituir la Unión Nacional, afianzar la justicia, consolidar la paz interior.
He's basically reading the Argentine Constitution in front of 1 million people who say, yeah, yeah. So that is the law in action, okay? He's saying we're working to constitute the national union, to strengthen justice. That words resonating 1 million people and say, yeah. So this, we need to understand that. The law is not just for judges and prosecutors. The law is for people. And then people need political leaders to lead them. And that's what this guy was doing in 1983. And then, interestingly, he was, as soon as he was elected, let me see, my system is not very good, I'm sorry for it.
De la Comisión Nacional sobre la Desaparición.
He created CONADEP to investigate what happened with the victims. And this is Ernesto Sabato, the writer, who was the president of the CONADEP. And he was saying, we need reconciliation, but reconciliation requires truth, justice, investigating what happened. That was the demand. So the CONADEP collected 50,000 testimonies, integrated them, analyze information. They were very important for us as investigators because we could investigate in 5 months because the CONADEP not just took the testimonies, they connect the witness, and these people went to this secret center, and this helped us enormously to do the investigation. So, I don't have a lot of time. So, my point is, to understand what happened in the Junta trial, we can do a legal analysis, but a legal analysis is not just for the judges. We have to understand why Alfonsín did what he did. There were personal reasons and historical reasons. He, in fact, was a human rights defender. And then he was normally the minority part of his party. But the majority guy was with the army guys. But lucky for us, the old leader died, and then Alfonsín took his place, and then he presented human rights, which was a big issue. He believed in that, but he had to use it as a political leader. And then people voting for him, people trying to understand what happened, because it's right what the army say. People were supporting the army, but when the information started to come, how they defeat the guerrillas, and when the information started to come that they torture people, they kill people, people want to know. And then that's why the Alfonsín proposal was gaining support. And then I like to show you, and that was what I was missing when I was an international prosecutor. You have, in Argentina, even it was a not perfect country at all, you have a Congress, you have an executive power, you have police, you have a state surrounding you. And all of them were committed. So the principal was the people, and the different agents were the different areas of the government working together. And then, yeah, you have the prosecutors and the judges who had to do the legal work. But you have different actors doing the activities. And that is, for me, what we have to understand to describe a legal system, how the different actors play. And I like to make this comparison. I like to compare Junta trial with ICTY and with ICC, because then we can understand how the international system is working. In the Junta trial, you have political leaders, but you have people as the principal. People was in a very interesting case in Argentina, because I think it's pretty unique. People vote, and the most important thing in the vote was investigating the past. And they were the principal. The ICYSDR is different. They were created by the Security Council. The principal was the Security Council. And the commitment is totally different. I was reading a book from Holbrooke, who was in those days managing the conflict in the Balkans. At the beginning, he was thinking this as the why was a PR operation. But then he said, but what could be useful? He explained. In his book, Holbrooke cannot mention ICY. He always put the wrong name. He has no idea what ICY was. And it's just to show the distance between the political leaders, those who were making the negotiations, and the court. And he was saying, oh, it's important ICY because was can arrest some people, as Karatik and Nadic, and then he was asking for others. So there is no connection between those who create the institution and the goal of the institution. And in some way, it's different, not similar. The ICC is different because it's more a permanent system. In some way, it's like a normal justice system in a country. So where the Congress did not define the case of the prosecutor, the Congress delegate, and the prosecutor decide. And that's similar in the ICC. It's a huge decision in international terms, but operationally it's complicated because you are alone. I remember a conversation I had with the general prosecutor from Germany. She visited me when I was a prosecutor at ICC, and I was explaining how was my work. And then she said, oh my God, Luis, we are not independent. You are isolated. And that's the point. So suddenly the world is okay. We do that, but there's no executive power, no commitment, there is no police, there is nothing. It's just the prosecutor. And your job is to be independent, but at the same time, you have to get cooperation and respect your rules. So my only point here, I will not go far in this, is when you see the difference between a national system and international system. So we have to understand that, because for me, the problem of lack of understanding is we are not watching what the other actors have to do. So at the beginning, the court has to perform, but now it's done. So when I started the prosecutor office at the SEC, the issue was about existence. Even the judges were thinking it will be closed in 1 or 2 years. Now, it's no more existence. The new building, $400 million, are there. The issue is about relevance. Relevance is not about judges or prosecutors. Relevance is about the other actors. When France was pushing to have that full referral, that was a political actor moving the ball. Then after the problem, they disappear. After that, they don't follow you. But at least there's something. Now, France received this attack from ISIS. I'm not talking about referring the ISIS situation to ICC. No, it's going to bomb ICC for 2 days and then they leave. That is for me the problem. The problem is if you are not focused on the different actors, we lost the understanding of how the game is. And then we are not requesting to the real actors more action. It's not about the court, it's not about the prosecutor, it's not about the number of cases. It's about how the political leaders take seriously the idea that this is wrong and should be investigated. And whoever is doing this illegal activity should be out. They are not doing this with Bashir. That's funny, no? Because you see, when Bashir went to South Africa, the South African leader was supporting him, but South African judges were arresting him. So it could not be possible that the law is just in the hands of the judges when you're facing the most powerful people in the world. You need power with the judges. And that is the missing point for me in the next years. And if we, or you as analysts, are not understanding this, nothing would change. So that basically, what I would suggest to you is go back to this. Yes, it's fine, you analyze the norms, after norms, it's fine, you analyze the judge's decision, it's fine, but it's not enough. You should understand how the other actors apply the norms, why they apply the norm in this way and in this other way, and how to integrate them, because that's what we need. If not, we are not understanding the legal system. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think you've done a great service to your prosecutor Fatou Bensouda. We've had it explained to us, don't blame the ICC prosecutor. By seeing the confluence of legal and political events that gave rise to the trial of the Juntas, the ICC prosecutor, though, has to wait for that perfect storm to occur in every case. And so it was very interesting to hear how your two careers have taught you some lessons. No, I would love to hear more from you, and I'm going to insist on it after we've heard, if that's okay, from Ruti Teitel. Which would be fair enough, wouldn't it, if I gave you that right? But I am a harsh chair, and I am not going to give you that right. Yeah. Well, why don't you continue? No, but why shall we...
10 seconds, you're out.
This is my fault. You can blame me for this continuing. No, I gave you ammunition. Please respond.
The point is, when you're in the ICC, you cannot wait for the storm.
I'll share this with you later.
Your duty is to apply the law, and you apply the law. And if they are not following you, I'm sorry, they are not following you. So that's
it. So please continue this conversation. We'll hear from Ruti in 15 minutes. And then we'll continue.
You know, we New Yorkers can speak quickly. So, great. So thanks to Luis. It's great to be back at the LSC and part of this conversation, which really takes me back 3 decades. We're commemorating 3 decades since the Junta trial. And it takes me back to the debates that surrounded transitional justice in the 80s, debates that started in Latin America, Argentina, the Southern Cone countries, and then went on to Eastern Europe. And as Devika mentioned, it's part of what animated my book. What I want to do is just throw out 4 questions and see if we could think about the Junta trials and the subsequent decades in Argentina as illuminating these 4 questions, because I really do think that there is a tremendous legacy. And, you know, if we're rewriting international criminal law, we're also rewriting or reviewing transitional justice. And that is the stages that Argentina went through in light of these 4 questions. So debates, the first debate was really how should societies respond to past atrocities. And here I would say that this first question often was posed as truth versus justice. And in a large part of Latin America, we saw that the choice was truth as opposed to justice. So Argentina, in a second, I'm going to say more about this, is distinctive for having insisted, as Luis pointed out, on truth and justice. The second question really goes to the parameters of punishment, and this was already alluded to. The third question is the relationship of punishment, retributive justice, and transitional justice. And lastly, and this has been echoing since the beginning, what's the relationship of domestic law and politics to the international? So let me quickly, in the time allotted, say something about each of these. As Luis pointed out, societies, Argentina, had to confront extensive periods of military rule and how to respond to the illumination of what had happened in secret detention centers. And so really this debate that took me into it, I debated at the Council on Foreign Relations. There was a hastily created discussion on this issue of whether justice would be necessary in the Southern Cone in order to have democracies. Certainly the truth part was a given. Operation Condor relied on a cover-up, on a governmental cover-up, so it wasn't just the disappearances, which were terrorizing enough, people disappearing from their homes, from their employment, from the street, but this was a dirty war where the juntas declared war on their own people, and it meant that the truth of military rule had to get out there. So it was really about addressing decades of cover-up as well as the disappearances. Argentina organized the first truth commission, and this is often not known. First Truth Commission of Modern Times, we tend to think of South Africa, Nelson Mandela, and Desmond Tutu as the first such commission, but it was not a Truth and Reconciliation Commission. It was it would be Truth and Justice, and it was chaired by a remarkable author, Ernesto Sabato, and the title, as Luis put on the screen, Nunca Más. Referencing the Holocaust, never again. But it wasn't just referencing the atrocities of the Holocaust, it was also a gesture to the future, because never again is not just about the past, but rather the notion that the story that starts in atrocities and is revealed will end on a new note, on a positive note. And this is really, you know, if there is a reconciliation in the Argentine story, the reconciliation is how do we reconcile ourselves to the facts? How does tragedy become somehow averted and lead to democracy? So the Truth Commission was established to show the lie of the regime. The dirty war was not against armed enemies of the state, but rather deliberate attacks, abduction, torture, and murders on unarmed civilians. And to be sure, there were some that were armed and that were guerrilla, but the large majority, and I would say that the most significant page of the Never Again report, there's one page, even half of it, has the statistics. 20% were students, just like most of you, unarmed students, and the evidence showed that. And if there was any crime they committed, it was the crime of opposing a military dictatorship, but they weren't part of the military guerrilla. So there was, it was extremely important to have this truth come out. The truth, and the further aspect of this was the fact that these crimes had been committed by the state security apparatus. The next stage, though, was the truth and justice. And we've heard a lot in recent decades about truth versus justice, as if these are somehow in contradiction or dichotomous. And what's really remarkable, and of course there were other countries in Latin America that would choose this idea that truth would go hand in hand with peace and reconciliation, like Chile and Uruguay and South Africa. And this is, you know, is very appealing. However, in Argentina, when the report was produced, the list of names went to the courthouse. And it wasn't an issue as well of two sides, of moral equivalence. The report didn't focus on the military, the guerrilla that had opposed the military. Instead, it was really about the acts of the government, because that was what they were focusing on. And the notion was that this was the problem facing Argentina. The disappeared were tens of thousands, but then you also had the cover-up, the denials by the government, the denials by all branches of the government, and this lack of acknowledgement, I believe, is what drove that pursuit of the project of truth and justice. So the goal in Argentina was not to reconcile with your torturer, but rather reconcile the country to its reality, and how to come to terms with the disappearance policies and a state that had violated the terms of really the social contract to protect its own people. Where could such a truth lead? And so the Nunca Más, which ended up being published in the papers, the Argentine papers, was read avidly. The trials that Luis participated again in would be public. They would be on the radio. It was extremely important to have this truth disseminated. But then the question began, what to do after that? What about the justice piece of it? And this leads us to the second question, which is about punishment. And what is the relationship of punishment and a sense of transitional justice? You know, would there have to be trials of all of those that had partaken in this policy, what had been a systemic policy to abduct anyone who had opposed the state, but not even those, anyone who happened to be in their address book, anybody who happened to be in the office at the same time. And I remember this because I was a kid and spoke with my grandmother, and it was a bit like Luis dealing with his family. There must be a reason, is what people said. There, you know, in the beginning, they thought there must be a reason if people had been abducted. In the preface of the New York of the Nunca Más book, which would end up being published by Farrar Straus, And in the pages of the New York Review, there were further involvement of philosophers from outside of Argentina, as well as philosophers on the cabinet of Alfonsín who struggled with these issues. You know, today it's lawyers that are dealing with it, but at the time it was mostly political and legal philosophers. And one of those early visitors to the trials was Ronald Dworkin, who came with Scanlon and others to watch a day of the trials. And he argued in the New York Review and in the first pages of the Nunca Más report for an absolute obligation to punish the torturers, not on backward-looking grounds, not on Kantian retributivist grounds, but rather for the future. He said the world needs a taboo against torture, and precisely because torture is already everywhere condemned, so it's already a part of the law. But then, as Luis mentioned, that's only a beginning of the process. It's really a question of how law is applied and interpreted. And because torture is almost everywhere used and disregarded, it's that gap that we have to address. And he said the best guarantee against tyranny, both in Argentina and other countries, was to send a message that this was absolutely unacceptable and repulsive. So it was really this that this piece of it that interested me, you know, the connection between justice and the future and democratization. And of course, there were many questions. You know, what would the parameters be? Could there be any amnesties? In a way, that first trial was the easier one because it involved the commanders, those who had given the orders. They had given orders to their units, and in fact, they were held responsible for those orders that were so aberrant. But the legal philosophers who were stuck in the cabinet having to figure out question of parameters of punishment had a very tough job because it wasn't really so much about the armchair perpetrators but the question of what to do with the junior officers, and there would be tremendous military resistance after the beginning of these trials. After Nuremberg, we could see that there could be indefinite liability, both from the top down and from the bottom up, because following orders was not a legitimate defense. So this project of punishment, which was so admirable in Argentina, started really threatening the Alfonsín government, and it's always hard to know, and political actors always have to figure this out, what's the point at which this is a serious threat to the continuation of the government. In any event, there would be subsequent laws passed, sadly, full stop law pardons issued by later presidents, Menem, and it really raised this question of the relationship. I'm on to the third question, the relationship of transitional justice and punishment. What would happen when politics got stuck in Argentina, when there was political paralysis, is that the victims hit the road and they and their representatives went to international institutions. They went to the regional court, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, and in a series of cases coming out of Peru, Paraguay, Chile, the first case was Velasquez Rodriguez, Honduras, but then Barrios Altos and other cases, there'd be numerous rulings that would conclude that there were legal obligations, not just to investigate and repair, but also to prosecute. And this is kind of tricky and problematic. What does it mean to say to a victim that they have kind of like a right, or that they have an expectation to have their case prosecuted? Another famous case that happened during that time, and another international involvement, or if you will, the universality move of in related cases, came out of Chile, and the case of Augusto Pinochet, who again we can thank the UK for the Falklands, but we can also remember the UK's involvement in the Pinochet case, where universality magistrate Baltasar Garzón, where victims had gone to Spain, made a request for extradition of Pinochet. Now, so this really relates to this second group of questions. What would this achieve in terms of transition back home? Chile had already come to its agreement to have some form of truth and reconciliation, and yet victims had hit the road and were addressing their claims to other fora, and there was already a sense at that point about the normativity that Luis had described, that there were norms about crimes against humanity, that with respect to certain crimes, they were jus cogens, that these were cases that could be brought in a great variety of institutions. The ICC didn't exist yet. The norms moved on, and you have a whole series of inter-American court rulings at that point that really produce another debate, and they would result in the overturning of amnesties in country after country in Latin America. And this redux, if you will, trials redux, would lead to another stage in Argentina, a stage where there would be a revisiting of the question of the amnesties and pardons. A period of transnational appeals would lead to constitutional change in Argentina. So it's not just an international coercion, but rather a constructive intervention where there would be the possibility, given that there were weak institutions at home, there was this kind of dialogue or engagement of international institutions with the local in Argentina. And following an important constitutional court decision in Argentina, the Simon case, you would have a reopening of the trials process and an entire period of revisiting these questions. So civil society was important in the period of political paralysis, but you end up needing, of course, a new government. This would be the Peronist government, the return of Peronists to Argentina, and they very enthusiastically took up these older cases. How did they see them? They saw them as human rights cases. This is a moment, given the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, where you see a human rightsization of transitional justice. I have maybe three, four more minutes. By now, we take this global stage of transitional justice for granted. We see that there are international institutions transnational norms, but I think it's really about the relationship of these two, and I think that the Argentine legacy here is very interesting because the Argentine trials policy started out as vividly independent. One of the first lines in the Juntas trial was, quote, this is not Nuremberg, okay? What did they mean? Not victor's justice, not another country telling us what to do. And of course, Argentina, coming out of a colonial past, it was very important to think about this as a matter of local ownership. But this is also too simple, this kind of dichotomy or contradiction. It really raises the question of what is the relevant community of judgment. These were kidnappings followed by murders, an enemy that opposed in the name of Christian family values. There were definitely aspects to these questions, crimes against humanity, this invocation of religion that had transnational aspects. If we think about how the president has informed the ICC, the Rome Statute, we can see all kinds of places with where we see evidence of the legal normativity that was started then. If you look at crimes against humanity, Article 7 in the Rome Statute, disappearances, which characterized the Latin American repression, Operation Condor was not just in Argentina. There was, there you saw a really horrible transnational repressive policy. Now that's listed in the ICC articles as a crime against humanity, a codification of the Argentine precedent. We also see through the Rome Statute that the international engages with the local through the notion of complementarity. And here, too, Argentina and Latin America in general was a continent which was very enthusiastic about the ICC. And so you can definitely see the support inhering in this, in the importance of this idea of accountability for crimes against humanity. And obviously, complementarity presumes that there would be the domestic crack at it first, so long as they're able and willing. Now, of course, there are proliferation of choices, and part of the idea, and I write about this more in my most recent book, which Devika mentioned, is this problem in a way of a proliferation of venues, but many actors that see themselves as having a stake in the matter. If you think about systemic persecutory policy, obviously there's going to be more than one constituency that has an interest in having enforcement of the law. But this trials policy really shows us, I think Argentina's trials policy shows us, the many relationships of this past to global justice. So in conclusion, let me highlight how one might think about it. It started out as local. But then, of course, the resistance came quickly. And then in the years of political paralysis, what we saw was the importance of civil society, some of them Argentine, but other there were connections to victims groups and NGOs and human rights institutions and actors in other parts of the world. And so, you know, you have that relationship. Then the international and transnational came back once politics got unstuck. And so you have this layering. And now I would say, and this is really, you know, Luis didn't say this about himself, but I do think that Argentina played an important part in informing international criminal law. And so we can see that aspect of it, this engagement between the local and the international. Having been among the first countries to call military to account for torture. And so just to end on that note, coming from the U.S. today and in the midst of a very controversial political election, we might think about Argentina's really the core, the important precedent is that they sought accountability for their state torturers. They opposed the notion of a dirty war where part of a population could be labeled as outside of humanity and as enemies of the state. Even in supposedly limited situations, the idea was that the bar should be absolute because of the facility of going down this road. So that struggle that Latin America had is really one that, you know, we've seen in the late 80s there, but we know, you know, repeats itself. And we can see, I think, given the last decade of counterterror, both in UK and the United States, the real significance of the Argentine precedent and the importance of talking about it today and in the future, the difficulty of bringing a security state to account, and yet the importance of a society that continues to demand it over a period of time. And I want to end on that ultimate message, and it reflects back on Luis's normative slides, which is really where there aren't institutions and where there aren't independent political actors, the importance of finding other spaces for application of existing norms and for, if you will, a kind of deliberative authority. So maybe I'll end there and we will have more of a chance for conversation. So thanks.
Thank you very much.
I'll move straight on to you.
So, well, thank you for the panel. What I thought I would do is just provide a little gloss on what we've heard rather than delivering some paper so that we can move into the questions. And the first thing, because I can't resist being a bit of a teacher in these matters, is to issue a reading list, which would include Carlos Nino's Radical Evil on Trial, which was one of the very first books I came across that wrestled with so many of these questions of history and law and reconciliation and retribution and so on. It came out in the late 1990s. That makes it really one of the very first, and I'll call it a sort of critical contribution to thinking about international criminal justice, local justice, and transitional justice. And it really does grapple with a lot of the dilemmas that have come up in this at this panel. And so the other thing that I would recommend is Ariel Dorfman's play, Death and the Maiden. And in this play, a woman who has been tortured abducts her torturer off the street and places him on trial. So she sort of privatizes the trial in a way that the national has sort of privatized international law at various points throughout history, but there's a moment in the play where we're not really sure whether this prosecution is a fantasy on her part and whether there is in some ways too much retribution. And I think that this is an important question when we think about international criminal justice and local justice. Is there a point at which we would simply think that there was too much retribution? Now, obviously, there are all sorts of nasty conservative reactionary forces that always think there's too much retribution. As one El Salvadorian general once said, it's time to throw a little bit of forgetting on the past. That just seems too pat. And Himmler is alleged to have said that Nazis and Jews should set aside their differences. Clearly, we need to reject that sort of thinking, but at the same time, keep in mind the possibility that there might be too much retribution. I was also struck by something Ruti said about the way in which this business had been handled by philosophers previously and had somehow been taken over by lawyers. So this is a common thing for me. I'm interested, maybe this is too pessimistic, but I'm always interested in the losses that accompany a triumph. It's probably some sort of Presbyterian thing. So one of the losses here seems to me the loss that's incurred when lawyers get into the business of reconciliation or justice or remembrance or history. So if philosophers used to do this, and I once argued that poets did it in 1914 to 1918, but lawyers have taken over that business as well. So we might want to ask what sort of losses are incurred when lawyers bring their technical abilities to bear on questions that are so morally troublesome and problematic. So I wanted to pick up something. No, but we'll have our discussion soon, I promise you. I wanted to pick up something about this relationship between the domestic and the international. So when I first got into this business, it was back in the late 1980s, I went to my supervisor at university and said I want to write a dissertation on international criminal law and superior orders. And he said, why? Nothing happened. Nothing has happened since Nuremberg and Tokyo. And I was really interested in the idea of something not happening. I thought this was worth inquiring into. You know, A, for start, why hadn't it happened after Nuremberg and Tokyo? But the second deeper question was, had actually something been happening that we hadn't noticed? And in some ways, part of my intellectual agenda over the last 10 years has been to show that quite a lot was happening between these two iconic moments, 1945-48, Tokyo Berg, and then the ICTY, ICC, and ICTR in the 1990s. And what happened was that there was a series of extraordinarily rich, morally, jurisprudentially, and so on, trials taking place in domestic settings that weren't quite identified by international lawyers as having relevance to international law itself. I mean, there were some key exceptions to that. So as you say, or I think you said it, everyone refers to the Eichmann trial. So the classic trajectory seems to be Nuremberg, Tokyo, Eichmann, and if you really know a lot, Klaus Barbie, and then onto the ICTY, ICTR, ICC. But in fact, during this period, a lot was going on. And so a colleague of mine, Kevin Heller, and I wrote this book called The Hidden Histories of International Law. But there's always a hidden history that you miss. And it turns out that the Junta trial was the history we missed in this particular case. And it's obviously, again, a very rich history to consider some of these particular issues. So there's been a long-standing relationship then between the domestic and the international throughout the history of international law. Lewis and I were talking just before the seminar began about the way in which the whole field begins with this relationship. The proposed trial of the Kaiser in a series of international trials to be held somewhere, not in The Hague. The Kaiser had absconded to the Netherlands, after all, and the Netherlands government was unwilling to give him up. But a series of trials were to take place of the German High Command and the Kaiser at the international level, wherever that happens to be situated at any particular time. What actually happened was that there was this deferral, as it were, as a form of complementarity, where the trials actually took place in Leipzig at the German Supreme Court. Now, those trials were very unsatisfactory in all sorts of ways, as many international criminal lawyers have pointed out. But this pattern was to be repeated throughout the whole history of international law. And indeed, we can't even decide whether the Nuremberg war crimes trial was an international trial or a domestic trial. I mean, certainly it's called an international military tribunal, but many people have argued that this was just the Allied powers exercising German sovereignty like an ordinary criminal court. And we see this relationship, as I say, throughout the institutional history of international law. And it reaches some sort of apotheosis with complementarity provisions at the ICC. The ICC is, in a way, a mixed tribunal. And we see it in the mixed tribunals themselves, which are an attempt to bring these two trajectories together, the national and the international. Okay, the last thing I wanted to say was something about this dilemma, the impunity, anti-impunity dilemma. And because anti-impunity, the idea of holding trials and performing some sort of retributive justice seems so attractive, I think it's worth pointing out that there's a great deal of impunity built into the history, structure, and norms of international law itself. Sure, the Argentinian generals produced this strange business of a self-amnesty, but international law has been about amnesty and immunity and forgetting right from the beginning. And I tend to always refer to the Peace of Westphalia, where international law is alleged to have begun, which indeed precisely begins on this note of forgetting, where in the Treaty of Münster, the great powers in Europe come together and say, look, we're going to reorder Europe now under principles of international law and sovereign equality. But one aspect of international law they just weren't interested in was retributive legalism. So they say, we're going to cast all the war crimes, or what we would call war crimes, this is obviously an anachronism, they're going to cast all the war crimes, crimes against humanity and so on, into oblivion. So I would argue that international law has a powerful law of oblivion built into it, and it's always, in a way, a negotiation between this law of oblivion, immunity, amnesty, and so on, and retributive legalism. And the reason it's built on that structure is because there's always an argument for oblivion, just as there's always an argument for retributive legalism. And the decision to go one way or another is generally a matter of politics, to go back to the very first set of comments that were made. And this politics is very often a politics of legalism. And the key text on politics, on the politics of legalism, was written by Judith Sklar in 1961 or 62. So I'll end also by issuing a reading a recommendation.
Well, thank you, panel. You've truly fulfilled the aims of this seminar series to bring together the practitioner with different types of academics. I realise we are running a little behind time out of our desire to hear as much as we can from our speakers. We'll just cut out the sing-along that I'd planned at the end. So we will open up to the floor, but I'm hoping, if you don't mind, if our speakers can then bring in comments responding to each other to allow maximum time for questions. Now, the wonderful Sarah is here with her roving mic. So I see a hand already. Can I see some further hands and I'll create it? Sorry, this lady here.
Yes. Yes, my name is Pilar Elizalde. I'm doing a PhD in international relations here at the LSC, and I am from Argentina. I have a question to Luis, and everyone can jump on board, about the justice cascade. I use that in my research, and I find interesting the normative interpretations of the different actors, but also when some issues become part of the identity of the state, and then as the state, it goes back to the international system. And she mentioned some examples of Argentina sorry, being a champion of the ICC and promoting international norms, like the International Convention for the Protection against Enforced Disappearances, or also the Right to Truth. So in your experience at the national and international level, how does that play out, that when something becomes the identity of the state?
I'm going to take three questions, if that's okay, and then we can have response. Thank you. At the back, red jumper.
Thank you. Nasser Colón. My question regarding how far Mexico would learn from Argentina. Last week I was in a workshop about the situation in Mexico. 36,000 missing persons, only 10 people being tried. So what the panel can say about it, and people refer to Argentina, like women who lost their husband or their sons, linking with a similar organization Argentina. So how far is it in the Latin world?
Thank you. One more question. Sorry, Sarah, we're giving you a workout. Other end of the room. Mm.
Charlotte D. Hall, part-time PhD student at Lancaster and full-time teacher. Is it not?
It doesn't.
Fine.
Hello. I'm used to being heard in my classroom. Yeah. I wanted to ask your opinions on, is the effect of justice lessened if the rule of law isn't applied to all? As in the case of the trial of the Juntas, obviously it were only possible because of the situation to prosecute a small number of people. So do you think that lessens the effect of justice or not?
Thank you. You have the floor. Yeah.
I can take your question, because after the Junta trial, we started to prosecute the others. And we had 1,500 people, suspects. How to do that? How to prosecute 1,500 persons? And all of them were probably criminals. So I had no legal criterion to discriminate. But you cannot do a trial against 1,500. So I remember I met Ben Ferencz, who was a prosecutor at Nuremberg, in New York in those days. And I was thinking, okay, this guy will tell me the advice. He will be the advice how to discriminate between my suspects. And I asked him, how did Nuremberg? And he said, oh, we have evidence against thousands, but we choose 22. I said, okay, here's the rule. How, why you choose 22? He said, well, there were 22 chairs at the Nuremberg room, so we choose 22. The real issue is...
The Marxist explanation.
Eh?
The Marxist analysis. Yeah.
No, no, the problem is this. First, the idea that no criminal justice in the world prosecute all the criminals. Zero. None. Even in Sweden. No one. So the idea that you can prosecute all of them when you have massive atrocities is impossible. It's not the goal. I remember in the 90s, a prosecutor from Ethiopia came to Buenos Aires to interview me because he was trying to prosecute 9,200 individuals. And I say, how you will this divide the trials? No, no, I will do all together. Please don't do that. He tried and he, of course, never did it. So the idea that we have this idea that everyone had to be prosecuted, no. Everyone has the risk to be prosecuted, but no criminal justice system in the world prosecute. If I can... The second, 20 seconds more. I think my problem with, I ask you why the lawyers, because I feel one of the problems for me when I am in this academic setting is you discuss details, but because I'm Argentinian, for me, the idea was not about just doing justice. The idea was to stop the crimes and to avoid the repetition. And in particular, when I was the prosecutor at ICC, I was always involved in ongoing crimes. So for me, it's a pragmatic question. It's not about justification of this or that. It's how we were more efficient to protect people. Because at the end of the day, that's the main goal. The main goal is to protect the people, to help people to when the most marginal people, who are normally the victims are the most marginal people, so they need support. How can you use new institutions, new ideas to protect them? That is, for me, the concept. That's why we need to understand the different mindset of different actors.
So, just on this last point, which is really this question of selectivity and rule of law. So I would say that, echoing what Luis said, that, and I think certainly in Anglo-American normativity on this, there's discretion, right? There's an understanding of prosecutorial discretion, but it can't be arbitrary, can't be discriminatory, it can't be for reasons that are unrelated. And we've also seen that, that given how much liability exists after the lifting of the Nuremberg defenses, even in the human rights community, and for sure, in terms of the applications, the precedents in the ICC, they've come up with a formula, which is those most responsible for the worst crimes. And I think that makes a lot of sense. And especially if you add the piece of it that Luis is talking about. In his most in the last comments, which is what is the relationship of this to the future, right? It's not just about getting every last murderer. We don't run our society by Kantian principles. That's a philosophy that seems out of vogue. And it's really always the future that's echoed in all of these statutes, the ICTY, the ICTR. They never talk about retributive reasons. They talk about the future. So I really think that's the piece of it we've got to think about, which is, what is the relationship that we imagine punishment is supposed to serve. So I think that's a research agenda. It really relates in part, it's an empirical question, Something along the lines of the work that Catherine Sinkink has done, but there's much more work to be done in terms of trying to figure out what the relationship is between these various measures of accountability and consolidation of liberal institutions and rule of law. I think that that's an issue. And the earlier question, people were talking about Argentina, it made me think about Germany as well, how Germany took on an international human rights identity and supported the institutions. That itself seems like a, you know, some way to respond to the past, to trade some kind of pathological nationalism for a more cosmopolitan human rights and law identity.
Yeah, that seems exactly right. I mean, I think to go to the first question again, some states think of themselves, there used to be a rule in the 19th century that a state became an entity, became a state or became fully civilized by beginning to observe international law. In other words, by becoming an international law state, you became fully civilized. And nowadays, it seems to me that there are states that identify themselves somehow as purveyors of international criminal justice. And the two examples I was going to give, in fact, were Japan and Germany. Germany sort of pushing the crime of aggression for reasons that you describe warily as pathological. It's probably obvious why that would be. So there was a question about Mexico. I think this is interesting because one of the things that international criminal justice does is it directs our attention to certain sorts of atrocities. This is a familiar idea, and it distracts us from others, or thinks of others as simply not being relevant to what we call crimes against humanity or war crimes. And I'm just delighted that somebody has asked a question about Mexico on a panel about international criminal justice, because Mexico is not a state we tend to think about when we think about crimes against humanity. Somehow, these particular crimes are thought of in a different way, and it's well worth thinking about why the field produces these particular effects and whether these particular effects might be in some ways invidious or prejudicial. On how many people you're supposed to try, I've always believed that it would be a bad idea to try everyone in any state, because that would be a horrible state to live in. And as I've said to my students frequently this year, I just don't want to live in a state where the laws are always enforced all of the time, for obvious reasons. You want to get home on your bike even though the back light's not working, this sort of thing. So it just doesn't make sense to live in a state like that. It would be a horrible, oppressive, Orwellian state. On the other hand, with international criminal justice, we do have a problem, there's no doubt. People say it all the time to me, and the thing they always say is, isn't it funny that no Western leader has ever been prosecuted since 1945? Or since 1940, or indeed at any point in international criminal law. And is that sort of omission or ellipsis fatal to the system? Probably not, but it's certainly a question that keeps getting asked, and it is one of the major selectivity questions that gets asked.
Okay. Let me comment on that. The issue is, for ICC, there had to be two elements, crimes and no national proceedings. And normally in UK, you investigate your crimes. You have people investigating. So that is one different. That's why at the end you end in countries who are not doing justice, like Africa. Two questions. On the identity, I don't think it's about identity about the states. They have no identities. People have identity. And what I saw in my country, what we call retributive justice, had an incredible impact in people. I always use the example of my mother. I never could convince my mother. During the time of the investigation, my mother loved General Videla. She was thinking he was protecting her, she was thinking I was totally wrong. The trial changed my mother's mind. After 2 weeks of the trial, my mother called me and said, I still love General Videla, but you're right, he had to be in jail. And when we did the case, we were rebels. When we were prosecuting, the junta leaders were rebels. The elite in my country were against us. Today, we're mainstream, totally mainstream, and that's, I think it's the impact of culture. And to end with Mexico, the problem of Mexico is different. It's a lack of monopoly of the state, of the monopoly of violence. Because most of the crimes are not committed by the state in Mexico, are committed by organized crime, and the state cannot control them. That's a new, different phenomena, different than the normal criminal justice system. So we, it's not ICC solving the problem. We need to, how we can really ensure the control of the monopolize the violence is a challenge, not just in Mexico, in Iraq, Syria. Poof.
Becoming more common.
Totally.
I'm conscious there's a business class section at the back that can hide. If there are questions from the front or
the
back,
it's a business class.
The first class. Do we have any hands? Always the front row, isn't it? But so you first, and then Anthony Dorfman. Sorry, we'll take the young lady first. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi. So my name is Alb. I work with Boston Consulting Group, and so. Briefly touch on Professor Teitel, who mentioned punishment before the rule of law. But there was also a very interesting case example of Klaus Barbie. So I know at the time in 1984, there was an investigative report by then the director of the OSI, who revealed that actually for 30 years, the US government employed him as a counterintelligence officer during the Cold War and helped him evade French prosecution for that amount of time. And so we discovered that international law is often censored as being very political. And there are different, there are multiple state actors with different. So my question is, how can we create a better system of cooperation between states and international legal prosecution?
Can you repeat the question?
So how can we create a better system of cooperation between states and international legal prosecution in light of this example of Klaus Barbie?
Anthony Dworkin with the European Council on Foreign Relations. So it seems like there are two kind of dichotomies which ran through all the presentations, one of which was about the legal versus political, that spectrum, and one was about the national, the international levels. And my question is about where these two intersect. So I can see the legitimacy for someone like Alfonsine, you know, to speak to a million people and to win 51% of the votes, or whatever the figure was, and then to use the law in a political way. But doesn't it play out rather differently on the international level, where you as the prosecutor of the international criminal court, you have a lot of discretion in the way you exercise your mandate, you know, and you're taking decisions which are in one level intensely political, but isn't it quite difficult for you to be, you know, in that position of deciding what the interests of justice, to take a phrase from the Rome Statute, dictate in a particular country? And, you know, I understand the doctrine of complementarity, but in a way the ICC comes first. So, you know, where does the international system decide, you know, what the interests of justice dictate in a situation like Colombia? And where should that sit in the international system? Maybe it should sit more with states and less with the prosecutor.
Thanks very much. So if we could see these as concluding comments as well, we'll take it.
Gary.
So do we want to go in reverse order?
Well,
yeah.
Why don't we?
Yeah, Gary first.
I won't take the Anthony's question. But I'll go to Klaus Barbie. Yes, Alan Ryan's report is the one that you refer to, and indeed it did reveal that the American security services had used several Nazis during the Cold War for various reasons. So the question would be, is the answer here to create a better system of state cooperation in order to prevent these deformities from taking place? So we treat them as diseases or pathologies, to go back to our favorite word from the panel, and we try and deal with them with some medicine. Or do we just think of them as sort of naturally occurring phenomena in the international system? So it may be indeed legitimate for the American security services to use Nazis in order to fight a war to the death with the great Soviet enemy. There may be other imperatives other than international criminal justice circulating in the system.
And so I think
we need to... Circulating.
Oh,
diplomacy, for example. I mean, the need to give immunity to people who commit crimes against humanity is vital in order for international diplomacy to continue unimpeded. So this may be an example of that. I'm not saying that it necessarily is, and I'm not saying I didn't celebrate when Klaus Barbie went down. But on the other hand, I wouldn't be too quick to condemn the operation of diplomacy, secrecy, and sort of interstate behavior.
Okay, so I have I want to comment briefly on both, and very rich conversation, great discussion. So on Klaus Barbie, I actually attended the trial, and it was thought that this was going to be a great revelation about France and the various sides they had taken on these issues. There was much more contestation in France about this, but in the end, it didn't materialize. Just to go back to the provocation, Gary's provocation about how to think about this kind of reasoning of lesser evils, right? And we've seen a lot of this of late. I think the only way really to combat that is not really at the state level. You know, you were talking about better relationships between states. We definitely saw at the end of the Cold War that once that ended, there was much more, you know, there were certain revelations and certain, you know, questions that we then found the answer to or a missing file. But I really think that it's only through a kind of independent thinking in the civil society. That's really the only bulwark against that this kind of lesser evils thinking. It's part of, you know, it's ISIS, Bin Laden, you know, this was, you know, support, U.S. support in Argentina and in the dirty war generally. Obama recently attended commemorations in Argentina, and he said he would open up the files that had been closed, right? So this will be another moment, right, where we're going to see the unfortunate support of the U.S. in the repression. And it should have come out in truth commissions, and it should have come out in truth reports, but it didn't. So I think that kind of the reasoning that leads us to have supported some of these extremely repressive religious actors, you know, in the fight against communism, yeah, really the only way to think about that critically is to have a more critical population and to have more contestation and more, you know, more, empowered, an idea of an empowered citizenry. And on the last point about which it was really interesting question, a relationship of these various legal and political and international and national, I guess the way I've been thinking about the ICC of late and these moments of where the ICC is most constructive is that Colombia is a great example of really, you know, and I know that this term is being thrown around in different ways, of constructive engagement, where the ICC actually, they're not telling the people what to do. In fact, if anything, it's more limited than the idea of some kind of absolute retributive state, you know, of the kind that Gary was talking about. It's just it offers a kind of alternative normativity that can be institutionalized and operationalized that in turn informs deliberations back home. So this is happening in real time now in Colombia, and I think that's, you know, very exciting. Some of the examples I gave about Argentina were different stages, and it was really blinkered over a period of time. So, you know, I think that's the best that we can hope for, really, is this kind of constructive engagement between the international and the domestic. But we're living in a global world where there aren't sharp distinctions in any of that.
Yes. I'll answer you with this map. This map show in blue the countries who are members of the ICC, in white, those who are not members. And that showed two different standards. The white is the classic standard, the standard you were talking, Gary, the standard where the states can decide to have secret service and kill people outside, and it's fine. And we are protecting them. In blue, it's different. These countries is like a community state with a very small connection. This idea, we started a rule that no one will commit these crimes. And we accept independent prosecutor to start the cases. And we give them, we give the prosecutor rules how to do it. But so in some way, the blue countries create a global confederation, where the prosecutor is a normal prosecutor, choosing case in accordance with the rules. But we are living also in the white countries where there are no rules, and states can do what Gary said. Because I live in a country where the white countries did that, that's why I'm so strong on that. You should not accept security services to commit atrocities. It's wrong. It's simply wrong. And talking about, of course, the rules, the prosecutor had rules, and then, for instance, on the interest of justice, what we try to do is show we are reducing our discretion. Security Council is in charge of peace. Interest of peace is different than interest of justice. Justice is about justice. So we try to be legalistic at maximum at the ICC. To understanding that sometimes we, for instance, when we indicted Bashir, we knew we'd be alone. We'd be with the flag in the hill, surrounded by people. But that's the role of the prosecutor. Put the legal limit and try to convince the political leaders to stop. You cannot do that. So I think that is the idea. The blue world is a world of the future, or it's a world with rules. The white world is a world with no rules, where power is everything. I believe it's better to have rules than no rules. No, I live in a country with the two situations. I live in Argentina when there were no rules, and now it's messy, but at least they are not killing us. So that's much better. Gary, I suggest to you, you live in London, in Australia, so that nice countries, no secret service and new people to kill. You have to abandon the idea to support secret services killing people outside. That's a wrong idea. The problem is, just to finish, the answer to your question, there is a institutional design problem in the world today, because the national leaders are selected by their own electoral people. They don't care about what's happening outside. They talk sometimes about outside. Obama was talking a lot about Darfur, but when he became the president, he did nothing on Darfur because he had different agenda. So that's a complex. There is no one in charge of global issues. In some way, the only global public servant is the prosecutor, ICC people. That's the only global mandate. The national leaders are national leaders. So it's not about establishing new authority because they don't like new authorities. ICC will not be established today. Today, no way the state will vote for ICC. So it was a moment in the 90s that we were trying to do that, stop it. So that's why I encourage you to understand how the different actors play and try to focus on that, because that's the only way to change that. I don't think we'll be in the next years a new design. We have to live with that. We have to live with this system, national systems, in some blue countries, some global prosecutors, and we have to see how to manage this to do it better. That is my recommendation.
Thank you very much. Well, what a dynamic and provocative panel we have had. I'm not sure you've simplified our understanding of the contribution of the trial of the Juntas to international criminal law, but even better, you've complicated it. So thank you for helping us rewrite a bit of history, and thank you all for your attention.